On tonight's South Bank Show, the incomparable Dusty Springfield. Arguably Britain's greatest ever pop and soul diva, Dusty Springfield is as much an icon of the 60s as the Beatles, Twiggy and the Stones. With a Hollywood biopic in the offing and a new musical based on her songs, Dusty Springfield's star seems brighter than ever, 7 years after her death from breast cancer in 1999. Tonight, we look at her landmark recordings and talk to close collaborators and friends, including tennis champion Billie Jean King, Kenny Everett's widow Lee, pop stars The Pet Shop Boys, Dusty's ex-girlfriend Carol Pope, and the stellar songwriter Burt Bacharach. Dusty's life was one of immense highs and lows, many of them hidden during her lifetime. And it's perhaps only now that her friends and fellow musicians feel free to reflect both on the degree of her talent and her torment.
I'm constantly peering in mirrors, and people say, my God, isn't she conceited? And I'm actually not seeing anything. It's really very hard to describe oneself anyway.
I just don't know what to do with my time. I'm so lonesome for you, it's a crime. Going to a movie only makes me sad. Parties make me feel as bad when I'm not with you. I just don't know what to do.
It's just a great voice. This is a voice that, like, is, you know right away who it is, you know. There are a couple of voices like that, and that's Dusty's one.
Burt Bacharach was one of Dusty's favorite songwriters and wrote some of the biggest hits of her career.
Each night of his charms that won't get you into his arms. So anyone who had a heart would take me in his arms and love me too.
I think that she was very, very judgmental of herself, and not necessarily right in doing that. But you know, a person is what they are. If they're tough on themselves, they're tough on themselves.
Everybody likes to be accepted and wanted and loved. And Dusty was all of that. She wanted all those things. But she also wanted to be true to herself. So there is a lot of push and pull, and she had a lot of demons because of it. I think her sexuality was difficult because I think she knew she was gay by this time. And there is no way back in the 60s and 70s that you were going to talk about it. Do you want to if you want to ruin your career, you can.
Dusty is probably even recognized now as the finest woman singer that ever came from Britain. She represented an amazing voice to me and an amazing kind of glamour and a different era of glamour and singing.
I think in the persona that Dusty Springfield adopted in the 1960s, you can see a conflict between the mask of the pretty, pleasant girl singer and then this tremendous other volcanic force, emotional force coming from beneath.
I don't know what else to do.
strange because you're hearing a kind of tragic muse coming from this rather typical British pop Muppet.
Sometimes people appreciate you, or me, or anyone in this particular business, and they like you for what you are and what you do and what you sing, and you might not think, after a performance, say, they come and say, you were great, and I didn't think I was great. And it took me several years to learn that it's very important what they think and not quite so important what I think. Because if it makes them happy, that's what I'm in it for, to make them happy.
We drank a lot, you know. The difference was her drinking turned serious. She became very, very, very morose and very suicidal, and she started slashing herself. She nearly killed me one time because she decided to kill herself in front of me. And she ran at the wall, and I jumped in between, because she was running with her head at the wall, you know, and I jumped in between the wall and her, and I was actually winded for a long time. She ran straight into me. She would have actually smashed her head. She was so determined.
It's a funny thing with my name. When I see it written or hear it spoken, it's I feel disassociated. It's almost another person.
She was just such a silly little English girl.
Mary Isobel Catherine Bernadette O'Brien.
But then she'd have very dark humor. But she could always make fun of herself, which I always think is very appealing. Like she'd look in the mirror and say, oh, I look like a drag queen today. You know, or something like that, or like just fun. And then other times she'd be very depressed as well. I think today we would know a lot more. I think she was probably manic depressive.
Dusty Springfield was born Mary O'Brien into an Irish Catholic family in 1939. The family moved to Ealing, West London, where Dusty grew up in wartime austerity. This is one of her first recordings as a teenage girl with her friend Peter Miles.
I thought I found the man of my dreams. Now it seems this is where the story ends. He's gonna turn me down and say, can't we be friends? I've offered words that couldn't go wrong. Not for long, I can see the way this ends. He's gonna
I think there was absolutely nothing for Dusty growing up here. She was not a particularly happy girl being in a convent school. I'm talking about when I knew her well from the age of 15.
Mostly you.
I thought I found a man I could trust. What a fuss, this is where the story is. She's gonna turn me down.
And she was just living for when she could do music. It was just her whole being. You're going to turn left here. This is Dusty Street, where she lived when she went to school every day. Went to school and came home, did her homework, and dreamed of America.
Within 10 years, Dusty had fulfilled her dream of becoming a star in America. In an emblematic moment, on her own show, she performed Can't We Be Friends with Mel Torme.
I thought I found the man of my dreams. Now it seems this is where the story ends. He's gonna turn me down and say, can't we be friends? I thought I knew the wheat from the chaff. What a laugh, this is how the story ends. He's gonna turn me down and say, can't we be friends? Never again, through with love, through with men. They play the game without shame, and who's to blame? He's gonna turn me down and say, can't we be friends?
I thought I'd found a man I could trust. What a fuss, this is where the story is.
Mary had, from the age of probably 12, an incredible inner drive to become a successful singer in music. She wasn't quite sure what it was going to be, but it was going to be American music. It's a wide enough term, isn't it?
I think for Dusty, she wasn't a great-looking girl. And I think she literally looked in the mirror and said, OK, what can I do about this? She totally reinvented herself.
Don't stand there waiting, got no place to go. Come on home. You look at me like that and I can't say no.
I think Dusty was always hiding behind makeup because she never realised how good she was. She always thought that she could be better and she should be better. And I think maybe that stemmed from the fact that when she was younger, Tom was always extremely clever. I mean, Tom speaks 9 languages. And I think maybe Dusty, as a girl and being the younger one, felt she wasn't ever good enough. And I think that's followed her through her life.
I think any star becomes a star to have a trademark talent or voice that is allied to a trademark look. And that's what makes someone a star, isn't it? And Dusty hit upon the eye makeup thing, the very dark eye makeup, and the, well, I think were wigs, the big bouffant-y wigs. It just created an archetype that resonates today.
The first British girl star to break through the male dominance in recent years. She has the most outstandingly distinctive voice on record, and I'm delighted to welcome Dusty Springfield.
Dancing in the street, they're dancing in the street.
Dust in 1963 when I'd just started working on a program called Ready Steady Go, which was a TV show.
It was just chaos. I mean, I had such a love-hate relationship with that program because I think I actually did more of them than anyone else. It was a documentary approach. And when the first ones were live, I mean, people wouldn't show up. They wouldn't be there when you announced them. And the photography was just diabolical. And it was just the immediacy of it.
Dusty was absolutely into music, and particularly into American black music. And she would start playing this, and I'd never heard anything like this in my life. And of course, I just was in love with it.
Later covered by Dusty.
I think that she's very close to the style that I sang the songs in, and she's done an excellent job.
Dusty had an attitude. Dusty had she had a kind of pain in her voice at times. There was definitely a sense of yearning, which is really crucial to soul singing, the sense of desire of not getting what I want, or, you know, of trying to reach out for it but not be able to quite get it.
Dusty's awareness of civil rights issues created a furore in 1964. She was one of the first pop artists to take a stand on segregation in South Africa.
Why was your contract different to previous ones? It was much stronger.
Well, I think that I may be wrong about this, but I think that in the case of most British artists who've been there before, they have played maybe one or two segregated concerts. And I didn't particularly want to do that.
She stuck by her guns. She was defiant about it. And she said afterwards, it wasn't that she was political, it was just that it wasn't right.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys.
The tumult of the so-called Swinging Sixties threw racial, sexual and class boundaries into limbo. New modes of contraception and feminism transformed women's roles. Dusty epitomised the conflicting impulses in Sixties society.
The great flaw of the 60s was that it represented a new freedom for young males and a very conditional and limited freedom for young females. With her extravagant clothes, the extravagant eye makeup, the gestures, Dusty represented, I think, the female sensibility that was struggling to get out.
I think Charles is absolutely right. I think that's exactly how England in the 60s viewed female singers. You know, they did want them to be the girl next door, boyfriends, potentially family down the line. It's still the same. It's one rule for girls, one for boys. I think had Dusty made an announcement, e.g. I'm gay, it would have killed her career dead.
She was almost a female drag queen, you know, girlier than girly. And that was a way of letting her gay and lesbian fans know, in a coded sense, what she wasn't allowed to express literally and freely at the time. I mean, in a lot of her public utterances, in interviews and so forth, she would use polari, which was a very specific gay slang.
Dusty's secret life remained sufficiently hidden to keep her in the mainstream, buoyed up by her own BBC television variety show between 1966 and 1969.
I think it's a very strange voice. I think that it's close to that of a countertenor or even a castrato. That is, it's an androgynous voice. The smoothness which she's able to go up and down, but almost a kind of masculine physical strength is in that voice.
In 1968, Dusty signed to Atlantic Records and recorded what many believe to be her defining album, Dusty in Memphis.
Billy Ray was a preacher's son, and when his daddy would visit, he'd come along. When they gathered around and started talking, Dusty and Billy would take me walking. Out through the backyard, we go walk.
It's the peak of her work as a mature soul singer, as opposed to the young girl romping around her favourite tunes. Here she is, a grown woman working in the home of soul music with one of the great session crews.
Being good isn't always easy, no matter how hard I try. When it started sweet talking to me, come on, tell me everything is alright.
And of course, the defining song is Son of a Preacher Man, one of the most gorgeous, swooning performances she ever gave.
Atlantic had a different sound than Motown. They more southern bass, really.
You've been crying, your face is a mess. Come in, baby, you can dry the tears on my dress.
They became so identified with a very kind of organic soul sound that was less polished than Motown, less, somewhat less arranged, but with a very, very rootsy kind of feel.
Don't be shy, you've been here before. Pull your shoes up, lie down, and I will lock the door. And no one has to know you've come here again. Darling, it will be like it's always been before. Come on over here, breakfast, bed, and a kiss at three. You don't have to say you love.
Dusty was an original who emerged from that great fountain of early American blues and gospel music.
In my neighborhood, we don't live so good. The rooms are small and the buildings made of wood. I hear the neighbors talking about you and me. I guess I heard it all, 'cause the talk is loud and the walls are much too thin.
In the first place, Dusty Springfield and the Chips Moments American Rhythm Section, according to most observers, would be the most improbable quinella in musical history.
That's what I heard them say.
There's no consonants there. How can you put Dusty Springfield in with this band of redneck braggamuffins with their southern style?
Jerry Wexler loved and depended on these fantastic R&B soul musicians, the rhythm section. These people played behind Wilson Pickett, Elvis Presley, so he thought, and he was right, that we cannot go wrong. And we also recorded many other of our artists with the same people. So, but when we took Dusty down there, the story changed, because she was used to record with a bigger orchestra. She would have this cushion of sound behind her so that she can emote and sing loud high notes and things like that. This wasn't like that. It was a very stripped down situation.
This, I know, was a source of great discomfort to her, until she just sat and listened and listened and finally had the genius to accommodate to it.
It's ironic that Dusty in Memphis wasn't rapturously received by the public when it came out, because in retrospect, it's seen as one of the supreme achievements of her career. And I think that took the wind out of her sails slightly, because, you know, it had been a very difficult album to make. In many ways, it represented the culmination of an artistic drive that she'd had for the first 10 years or so of her solo career. And I think she felt lost.
Early in the 70s, I sensed that were beginning to have enough of me. And I was certainly beginning to have enough of the disenchantment I was feeling. You know, I didn't know what else I could do. They weren't that impressed anymore.
How can I show in a world that's constantly changing? How can I show I'm
the peak in England. There really wasn't anywhere else for her to go. She saw America as the next big step, which would take her into international stardom. And it should have done. But unfortunately, the team she hooked up with didn't understand a pop singer moving on up. I think they didn't know what to do with her. And it was a huge disappointment to her.
I did get very depressed and very despondent. I mean, if you sit around and things are not going your way and you wonder really what the hell you should be doing, if, I mean, what else are you going to do and try and get it reorganized, but not do it on your own, because I didn't have any management, and not feeling comfortable with Los Angeles and feeling sort of awash and adrift, it was a very despondent period in my life and things were not easy at all.
She was very, very lonely. She was totally on her own out there, and nobody came forward with the right work for Dusty. And I think she just got drawn in with hangers-on, quite honestly, that just wanted to use her for her name, but when she didn't do anything over there, by that time she'd got drawn into drink and drugs and was slipping down the ladder. So nobody was using her anyway.
In Los Angeles, Dusty's sexual adventures took her into a violent gay marriage with a woman called Tedda.
The wedding with Tedda, it wasn't public. I mean, it was very much within her friends, people that knew her. God knows why. I mean, Tedda's a loose cannon at the best of times. Most unstable person, and another one very, very similar to Dusty in a lot of ways, had been in and out of prison. Just bad news all round. But obviously there was something about the danger of it that attracted Dusty. It didn't last.
Tedda seemed like a complete freak and apparently hit Dusty, and I met her once and was frankly a little bit frightened.
In an even more bizarre twist, headlines appeared claiming that Dusty was dad to soft porn stars the Barbie twins. How can I
be sure? Well, the Barbie twins' mother was Dusty's partner for a while, but they were friends. They remained friends for 30 years. And also, people don't know is that Shane and Sia's mother was Dusty's AA sponsor. So she actually helped her through all her downfalls with her alcoholism and all that kind of stuff.
She obviously had a drinking problem, and low self-esteem and just a million issues, but I was still fascinated. I knew it was just gonna be trouble, but I just went there anyway. Dusty was recording White Heat and she was looking for material, so I'd written this song, not about her, but about being with an alcoholic.
You brush by me and my whole facade just melts. You seem a bit twisted, but that makes me more intrigued. You drag yourself through a maze of alcohol. Neon lights can't seem to hold on to your love.
She'd started slashing herself. I always thought it was for attention. It basically was her crying out for help, you know, because she really was out. She always said that when I brought England to her, that was one of the big things when I visited her. I don't think she ever got happy in America.
Dusty's self-mutilation was, like, really horrifying, and I think, I mean, we talked about it after the relationship, and she just said she was trying to see how far she could push me, you know? But it was, like, really horrible trying to fight, you know, get the knife out of her hand.
She knew she was in trouble with the drink and the drugs, and she decided that, okay, this was it, and she was going to get over both things. And I have to say, my admiration for somebody that can get out of drink and drugs knows no bounds. And she did it.
Can't see, understand your love.
Dusty left her addictions and Los Angeles behind her for good in 1988.
I have a tendency for overkill, to complicate matters.
because I don't think my voice is enough, therefore I have to invent this kind of vocal decoration and acrobatics and stuff. And really, you can't do that to a Pet Shop Boys song. They write songs that are meant to be sung rather plainly.
Well, when Dusty came in the studio, she said, how do you want me to sing it or something? And Neil said, we want to sound like you. And so I think she's a bit unsure of her own ability, maybe. I think she's maybe a bit insecure about her vocals and everything. And I don't think she really enjoyed doing them, did she?
They were so patient. They let me go through all these gymnastics. And they weren't saying anything. I suppose they were a bit frightened I might blow up or something, you know.
What was fascinating and slightly frustrating is how long it took to work with her. She got in front of the microphone, she'd always had a cup of coffee and a cigarette, like this. She started on the first syllable, which was the word Mandy, and she went ma at that. Mm-hmm. And she says, okay, start again. And you wind the tape back, intro, sounds great, you know. No, start again, will you? And I thought, I looked at the lyrics and I thought, oh. I can't believe it. Mm-hmm. And we want to double track it. I just then became fascinated by how she did it because actually it's a very intellectual process. She was taking the words and the melody. She said she didn't care what the words meant, by the way. She said she never ever listened to the words. But she'd take the melody and she changed it. She personally arranged the melody. So each verse and chorus was different. And this song, Nothing Has Been Proved, which is a lovely sounding thing, is actually almost a recitative, really. It's not much of a melody. And at the end, Dusty, it's like someone running up to do the high jump or something. She's thinking about it. And then suddenly, she takes it up, just like she did on What Better Deserve This. And she gives it this incredible, it may be false, it may be true thing at the end. This incredible Dusty moment, which really isn't written in the song. And she turns it into her, and it's a thrilling moment.
After her success with the Pet Shop Boys, Dusty was diagnosed with what proved to be terminal breast cancer.
Dusty could be a diva when she knew it was okay, but with the breast cancer and things are truly serious, you know, life-threatening, that's when Dusty revealed her true character and how much grit she really had.
Regarding the illness, I thought she handled it extremely well, and she went through a lot of it with Linda McCartney. Linda McCartney, she told quietly. She never told anybody else. And they used to chat for ages. And I, unfortunately, was the one that had to pass the news on to Dusty when Linda died. And it was horrific, because Dusty just screamed down the phone, no, you've got it wrong. She couldn't believe Linda had gone. And Paul was very good to Dusty when after Linda died. He still rang her for a while and kept her going. But, I mean, herself, I think she took it really stoically. I mean, I don't know whether I could have managed to do what she did. But there you go, that was Dusty.
Dusty Springfield, one of the icons of the music industry, has died after a five-year battle against breast cancer. Her death last night came on the day she'd been due to go to Buckingham Palace to collect an OBE.
I think I'm going back to the things I learned so well in my youth. I think I'm returning to days when I was young enough to know the truth. Now there are no
Dusty's funeral, they played, right in the, towards the end of it, I think, they played Going Back. And the coffin was there, and this amazing voice.
Admire her for being able to guess it out in a very, very difficult environment in those days for her to have a career. And I think we owe a lot to her.